My name is Christophe Aguiton. I'm French, as you can recognize with my accent, easy. And I am both activist in some circles, but also academic in others. About my job, I come historically from the telecommunication sector. You see, we are a little bit far from academic. I come from a company named Orange. You know it because it's one of the big companies in France and in several other countries. But in Orange, in the last 17 years, I was in the research center, in the R&D, research and development. And as in all companies, you have research and development, which is not exactly the same. And in Orange, as you can imagine, it's a very technical company because it's looking about cell phones and all those things, internet access and so on. You have a lot of engineers who are really technical people. But we are a little laboratory on social science. We are 30 in a R&D who has more than 3,000 people. And that gives you an idea. We are 1% of the big R&D of Orange. That's my job. But today I'm almost quitting my job. I'm not there anymore. I will be there 1 year more, but it's finishing. But I have another position. I am what we name in France, but that exists in other countries, associate teacher at the university, which are people coming generally for private sector or other research center, and who can do what the academic in the French academy cannot do or have difficulty to do. One of the particularities of the French Academy, you probably noticed it, it's when you are economist, you are not sociologist. When you are historian, you are not geographs. And you have a very clear separation between disciplines, academic disciplines. And my job is to talk about digital and society. And when you talk about internet and the digital world and society, you have to do a lot of sociology, but also a little bit of economics, a little bit of history, a little bit of political science. You have a sort of mixed up, mash up of different social science. It's what I do. And I'm teaching in masters in Marne-la-Vallée, which is in the east of Paris. That's my job. Today I'm just finishing 4 hours this morning, that's why I'm a little bit exhausted. Be nice to me, because I will do my best, but only to let you know. What I will present to you, it's a paper you probably got, because it was sent to everyone. You get the English version. If some of you are not mother tongue English, this chapter was published in a book in 3 languages. One book in English, one book in Spanish, one book in French, and it will be published later on in German and Korean as well. Meaning that if you want to have other languages, I have them in the computer, and I can give you the French or the Spanish version. The other one, Korean and German, you have to wait. You have to send me a mail if you want to get it in a few months. Okay, that's what I will present to you. And this job, this chapter, was written not really in an academic circle, but more in an activist circle. And that's the second side of my activities. I am part of what we name in French the alter-globalist movement, which is the movement who start after Seattle in 99, long ago. You were very young, most of you, and which was able to challenge neoliberal globalization. We could say that the big movement of 2011, 2013 in Spain, in the US, in England, like the Occupy, the Indignados, the M15 in Spain, or then in Turkey, the big movement of the Ginzi Park, or in Brazil, the Passe Libre, all those movements have the same roots and come a little bit in the tradition and following up the alter-globalist movement. In this big movement, we have also people who work a little bit at the border between academic and social movements. And I am part of a project named Systemic Alternatives, which is done by 3 organizations. In France is ATTAC, which is a quite strong alter-globalist movement in this country. In Latin America, we work with a Bolivian organization named La Fundación Solon, which is quite important because they were able to link all the Bolivian and the Andean world with the Social Forum. And in Asia, we work with an organization which is mainly in the Southeast Asia, based in Bangkok, named Focus on the Global South, but who has also branches in Delhi, in India, and in Manila, in the Philippines, and starting to open a branch in Phnom Penh, in Cambodia. Okay, those three organizations wrote a book named Systemic Alternative, in which one we are presenting different concepts who are emerging mainly in the social movements, but also in the academia. Some of those concepts are, for example, the buen vivir, the vivir well, the living well in English, which is a concept coming from Bolivia and Ecuador, which means to have a different relationship with your environment and to not live only in a consumerist world, to tell it very quickly. Another concept is the fact that we can give fundamental right to the nature, and not only to the human, is all the idea of the right of Mother Earth, and behind that a lot of concepts were developed by them, the Bolivian and the Ecuadorian. There is a chapter on ecofeminism, how ecology and feminism can be articulated together. There is a chapter on degrowth, and there is a chapter that I wrote on the commons. It's what I will present to you. But it's part of this book, which has these different chapters. And you can find it, I can write it to you on the web. I think that if you look at in what word? I suppose it's .org, I'm less sure of that, but if you have at least that on Google, for sure you will find the website of this project where you will get all the text I was presenting quickly to you in at least English and Spanish. And the French one will be updated a little bit later. Okay, about the presentation, you see who I come from, what I do, and why I'm presenting you this paper. Okay, this paper, the commons, I know that you have some of you who are following a special teaching with Benjamin Coriat, which is in this teaching in this master, which is part, is now what we name emerite, meaning retired, but he was in the same laboratory and research group in Viltaneuse than David and you. And Benjamin Coriat, who is following his specific branch? Okay, you have the third, more or less, it's what David told me. When I knew that, I said to David, do you think it's reasonable to present the common, because you will talk about it? He said, yeah, do it, because it's another approach. Okay, let's do. You will see. You started with Benjamin Coriat, or you will start? Good. You will see. And reading my text, the things are quite similar, no? You have a lot of approaches who are the same. But it's a way to go a little bit further and to have a different voice talking about that. The commons, it's a term which is now growing both in the academic circles and in the social movements and activist circles. In the academic circles in France, we have several books talking about. Benjamin Coriat wrote a good one. You have a lot of others. If you're interested, I can give you the bibliography. But you have also books in English. There is a common strategy group who was led by an American guy named David Bollier and a German woman Silke Eichfritsch. And both, plus David Bowens from Belgium, publish a lot of texts on those issues, and you have really a big bibliography in English. I suppose that Benjamin gave it to you, for those of you who are following this curriculum. And what you can do is to send to all, I suppose you are in Facebook all together, you can send all this bibliography in English for those of you who are not following the Benjamin Coriat teaching. Why the common are important? First at all, what is the origin of the term? Historically, the word commons, or commons good, or the common, in singular, are describing similar practices who come from the Middle Age in England and Western Europe. But those practices were mainly the right of use or usage of the farmer in the feudal time, in the feudality. To be very concrete, in a lot of places of the Western world in the 12th, 13th, 14th century, the farmers were half slave, they were not really free. They had to work for the landlord, for the guy who was the seigneur, the lord, but at the same time they had a certain number of rights. For example, to take the wood was falling down from the trees in the forest, or to take mushrooms, or to take these kind of things. But they never had the right to hunt, for example, to kill animals. That was absolutely reserved for, to the landlord and the seigneur, the lord. But these particular right, which is a very specific usage, use right, was named the common. And you all know probably this carta, named the Magna Carta, was written in 1215, who was the beginning of the habeas corpus and the beginning of the recognition of the individual right of people in a particular kingdom, in this case in England, was also accompanied, there was another carta, was the Carta of the Wood, who gave in a very written way the different right the farmers had to live, only that, to be able to eat their house, to cook their food, and so on and so on. This notion of commons is not only de facto only limited to Western Europe. The description I'm giving to you, it's really the Middle Age in Europe. But in fact, if you go to Asia, if you go to America, to Africa, and the rest of Europe, you had almost everywhere this kind of collective right attached to a particular land. There is different name for that. If you have people from Mexico here, you have the ejido. El ejido is the village who has the collective right on the land. But you have the similar things in Africa, and I'm sure in most of the country you are belonging from or you know. It's something which is very common, while the way in which when humanity, before the capitalist era until the 17th, 18th century, was able to organize their relation with the nature, with their environment, and this relation was most of the time collective or half collective. On this way, we can say that this idea of the commons, even if people didn't give this name at those realities, was de facto universal. You can find them more or less everywhere. Okay, that's the beginning of the notion. Then we could, before to talk about the history of the common, one first issue. It's clear, and I'm sure that Benjamin Coria said the same than me, that the commons are not a particular type of goods, not at all. And that could be a mistake to think like that. For example, people in the day-to-day language can say water is a common good. The air is the common good, the forest in general is a common good. That makes no sense at all. Water exists before humanity. If we disappear one day as a species, the water will be still there and doesn't need us to be there. What is a common is our relationship with those elements. For example, if you are living in an oasis in the Sahara and you have a little source of water, a little river, who give you the possibility to grow vegetables, cereals, and all these kind of things, the management of this water is absolutely key because it's the only way for the farmer to survive in a very dry desert. And this management makes the water becoming a common, but it's only because you have this relationship between humans and the physical element, in this case water, that we can talk about commons. Commons are not a category of things, it's a social relation. That's the key element. And that is something which is more or less unanimously accepted by academics and by activists. The commons are not a thing, they are a social relationship. That is extremely important to understand. If not, we are talking about different things who are so different that there is not so much to say about. That's about the nature of the common. Then the history of the common, it's interesting because you had different steps in which one similar relationship than the commons were emerging. After these those historical commons who are really related to agriculture and to farmers mainly, we had in the 19th century an attempt from the working class to fight against capitalism and to create another kind of relationship between humans to produce goods than the capitalist factory. Those movements, because they were not only in one country, but they started in Britain, in Great Britain, in England, mainly because it was in this country that the industrial capitalism was born in the second part of the 18th century. And during the 19th century, as you probably know, there was a lot of struggle from the working class in England. In the first part of the 19th century, the name of those movements were the Chartism. And this movement, the Chartism, was led at intellectual level by one of the first socialists, name is Owens. The Chartism, and the main theorist was Owens. And what Owens was thinking is that to replace capitalism and to fight capitalism, the only way to do is to create cooperatives, worker cooperatives, meaning that the property will not be the ownership of one person, the capitalist, the leader of the company, the factory, but a collective ownership from the workers who could be able to manage their own factory for their own purpose. At this level, we can see that the cooperatives are very similar to the commons from the Middle Age, were more in relationship in the villages, in the countryside. There are the idea that the ownership of the factory, it's an ownership of usage, meaning the worker is one of the co-owner when he's working. But if he's leaving the factory to go somewhere else, he didn't have in his pocket a share of the company. He was only having a share of the company when he was part of, when he was working in. And at this level, you have a little bit the same kind of relationship than between people in a village managing the forest or the water or the relationship with the field to get their cattle to have food and to have grass and herbs and all those things. And we can say that this second step of commons, the cooperativism or the cooperatives, was extremely important for all the socialist movement all during the 19th century, in Britain first, but then in France, in Germany, in the US, in all the places where capitalism was growing. Then, and that is an historical important moment, the common good, and in particular the cooperativism, was put away of the discourse and on the thinking and on the strategy of the socialist movement. And that happens at the end of the 19th century. Why the end of the 19th century? If you remember a little bit the history of economics, I suppose you had that in this master or before, we had in the 19th century a relatively long phases of globalization. Not exactly the same than the today globalization because internet was not there and the reality were of course different. But you have a long period of free trade dominated by Great Britain because England and Great Britain was the center of the world empire at this time. And under this leadership of Great Britain from 1840 to 1880-90, the world was managed in a sort of open trade system, quite similar to the today open trade system. These phases of globalization start to collapse at the end of the 19th century for different reasons I will not enter in because it's not the point of this teaching. But the world of the 20th century was mainly a world in which one, the nation state had a strong control of their country, of their economy, and had to build a new phases of colonialism to have the sort of backyard in which one they could be able to sell their product and to extract the primary goods. And if you look at colonialism, for example, during the 19th century, colonialism was seen as something from the past. Most of the colonial countries were free in the 19th century, all Americas, starting by the US because of the independence war at the end of the 18th century, but all Latin America, and starting by Haiti, the ex-French colony was the second independent republic through a big revolution, and then all Latin America became free. And in the 19th century, the colonialism was seen as something from the passé, something really out of touch. And it's only at the end of the 19th century, through the Berlin Conference and all those different events, that the second wave of colonialism starts with the division of Africa, who was occupied by French, British, mainly a little bit the German and Belgium, the separation of several parts of Asia, all the Cambodge, Vietnam, and so on. And these second phases of colonialism is very related to the fact that the nation state were out of this free trade system because it was the end of the first globalization. The big nation state needed and wanted to have a colonial empire. And at this moment, at this particular moment, the socialist movement was obliged to think differently. And they adopted a vision of socialism was very different than the cooperativism. And when I said socialist movement, it's not only the Marxist movement or the what will become later the communist movement, it's also the labor movement in Britain. You know that in Great Britain, the labor movement was inspired by a society named the Fabian Society. And this Fabian Society was extremely anti-Marxist. They really hated Marxism and those theories. They had very different philosophical and vision of the world. But at the same time, all together, the people under Marxist influence, mainly in the continent, in the European continent, and the labor were developing the same idea. To change the society, to finish with capitalism, the first things to do is to take the state, and when you have the state, to nationalize the big companies and to planify the economy. And there was this idea that only the nationalization and planification of the economy and the creation of huge corporations was the way to have an exit from capitalism. This vision of socialism was developed, of course, in the USSR after the Russian Revolution 1 century ago, also in China, in several other countries who adopt the communist model. But even in the West, where the communism was not able to win, the Social Democrat Party believed in the same way, and you had in England, in France, in several countries, waves of nationalization, in particular after the Second World War. Also with this idea that by nationalizing the economy, planifying the economy, they could be able to change the relationship between the workers and bosses and to change the regime of the countries. In this vision, there was no room for cooperatives. And there was even less room for the poor farm and forest leaded by the farmers in the sort of old middle age relationship and tradition. There was really something was dying at this time. And the turning point, if you want to be more in the academic term, really the moment where the commons were discredited the most was in 1968, when an economist, a theorist, wrote this paper, relatively well known, probably Correa talked about, named The Tragedy of the Commons. The idea was very simple, to say that the commons have to die only because they are structurally unable to survive. The theory of Hardin is to say, to give a very simple example, that if you have some field who are common good, the farmer will start to bring their cattle, their cows and sheep and goats, to those fields first, before to use their own field, and because everyone will rush to the common good will be exhausted. And the conclusion of Hardin was to say that's why either the public sector or the capitalist market are the only way to make the field to manage the field in a good way. That was the moment where we could see that both socialist theorists plus academical economists decided to finish with the common forever. Okay, we know now that it's not what's happened. Both at theoretical level and at practical level, the commons are reviving today. There's a sort of big revival of the commons. Why there is a revival of the commons? First at all, because this idea to have as an alternative to capitalism, only a system giving to the state all the power, is not something which is so sexy today. We have the evaluation of the USSR, and frankly, this system, no one wants to copy it, and I don't know one person in the world who thinks that that was the good example and we have to come back to the USSR. But even in the free world, like France, Britain, and so on, the experiences of the nationalization of companies were not so successful. When you look at my country, in France, François Mitterrand was a socialist president in 81. He nationalized big part of the economy. A lot of companies were nationalized because it was the agreement between communists and socialists, what we name in France the programme commun de gouvernement, and there was a big wave of nationalization. The result, even for the right of workers, were not very interesting. And no one were really defending these phases of nationalization. That's the first reason why people believe that we have to look at something else. And the commons appear as something who could be interesting to be both anti-capitalist, because the commons are not capitalist at all, but without to be statist, if you want, and to believe in the absolute necessity to pass through a state leadership. And this idea of the common become important in social movement and later on in academy because of that. But because also a second reason we explain why the commons became popular is that there is new generation of commons. One of those generation, and it's an extremely important aspect, is all the knowledge. The knowledge saw the commons arriving in the 80s, 90s through the free software. If you remember a little bit the story of computing, until the 80s, 81 more precisely, software was not something who had a specific value. What you bought at this time was a computer. And the operating system was in, but you didn't buy the operating system. You buy the computer exactly as when you buy a car, you don't have in your bill a specific line to sell the software which is in the car costs 200 euros, for example. Huh? Or there are software in car. You saw that in Volkswagen when they changed the software to pass the test on the pollution level. Huh? But you never buy a car with a specific line telling the software is 200 euros or 500 euros or whatever. You buy a car. That was the model of the computer market until 81, when Bill Gates passed a specific agreement with IBM, and that was the beginning of the proprietary software. Against that, a big movement of free software starts. It was Richard Stallman, probably you know his name, which is an American engineer, anarchist, very hardline, a very good guy, very like that, who created the concept of the free software with the general public license. You probably all know those things. I will not be too long on this issue. But Stallman himself presented the free software movement as common good for humanity, because he said that it's a way to develop something which is a common good that for the whole humanity, immediately. And the interesting thing with the free software is that for Bill Gates and all the bosses of the technologies in the 80s and 90s, the free software was the first enemy. To give you a quote from Bill Gates, in the beginning of the 90s, 10 years later, Bill Gates explained, he wrote it, that the free software is more dangerous for capitalism than communism. And when you have an American CEO who say that, and when you know what communism in the 90s means in the US, which was really the devil, to say that free software was more dangerous than the free software was most dangerous than communism, that gives you an idea of the tension in between the two kind of development software development model. Which is interesting in the case of the free software is that today the free software won. You have to really to be dummy to develop proprietary software. No one do that anymore. And even Microsoft is changing its business model because its old business model is dying. Who here will be able to pay 300 euros to buy Microsoft's Office? No one. It's something from the past. Your parents bought Microsoft Office when they had your age, but today no one will do that. You get it for free, you copy it, or you get Open Office or Free Office. So you have a lot of way to avoid to pass by this kind of proprietary model when you have to buy Microsoft Office or this kind of things. And we can see that today the free software model won in this industry. But behind this industry, you had other knowledge commons were emerging. All the creative commons were commons given to all intellectual property or intellectual realization, more precisely. You have, of course, realization were absolutely unbelievable for the capacity of giving access to knowledge at the whole humanity, like Wikipedia. You have today in the academy also a movement to give free access to paper, academic paper, to people, because today you know that when the academics are judged and paid not in relation to their pedagogy. They could be good teacher or bad teacher, no one cares, except you, the students, but in the academy that doesn't matter. But we are judged and paid in relation to our paper. And those papers are generally published in journals who are private company journals, and to run them and to buy them in for university, it's a very expensive matter. Probably in Epoch there is no problem because it's a relatively good master in the sense of there is money in. But if you are in Ouagadougou, in the Burkina Faso, or in Haiti, or in Cambodia, or whatever, try to get those papers. No way, no way. That's why in the academy, a lot of people are developing a new approach, which is to give status of commons to those academic papers. Okay, in general, you have all these new generation of commons, the knowledge commons, and they have a big interest, which is the fact that they are able to give to humanity new fundamental rights that the old common was not able or were not able to give and to deliver. To come back to the 19th century, it's also one of the reasons why the old common, the cooperative and the farmer common, were disappearing from the socialist movement, is that in the end of the 19th century, there was a claim for a new generation of fundamental rights. I stop 2 seconds on this idea of fundamental rights. Historically, the fundamental rights of humans started to be discussed through the big revolution of the 18th century, the US Revolution, the French Revolution, who created those concepts of right for human citizen. The French Revolution wrote a big text on that. But all those rights were civic rights. The right of expression, the right of demonstration, the right to vote freely, all those rights were extremely important. It's not at all to discredit them. But only those rights were expressed as fundamental rights. In the 19th century, emerged a new idea, which is the fact that, of course, those rights were important, but we have to add a new generation of rights, where all the social rights, right to education, right to housing, right to have access to hospital, right to, et cetera, to labor, all those new rights, we name them the social right or the positive right, were recognized only after the Second World War in the Charter of Human Rights of the United Nations in 1948. But it's only at this time that they were recognized at international level by the international community. But in the end of the 19th century, those rights were really at the center of the claim and the revendication and the exigence of the socialist movement, both parties and unions and the social movement in general. And those rights, education, housing, labor, health, and all those things, of course, the old common, the cooperatives, or the farmer common, were not able to deliver them. And only the state was seen at this period of time as able to deliver those rights. That's why also the believing on the power of the state was so strong in the socialist movement and in the working class movement. But today, talking about the knowledge commons, look at the internet itself, or look at Wikipedia, the two most well-known realizations of common knowledge. They were not done by state. It's not the Ministry of Education in France or in your country who decided to publish Wikipedia. It was neither capitalism. It was not a private company who decided to create Wikipedia. It's us. It's our movement, our own movement, who decided to write and to enrich Wikipedia. We could say the same about the internet and other realizations like that. And that shows that the commons in certain kind of activities can give universal right, to knowledge in particular, through another way than the same the state system, through our own development and our own activity, like in the case of Wikipedia or even the internet. It's another issue, but believe me, we can say that the internet is a little bit the same. And you have also another generation, the latest one, which is also emerging, which is again our relation to nature. And that emerged because of the big challenges of ecological concern. Look at the quality of the air. If you are in China, in Beijing, it's probably your first concern. When you open your television in the morning, what you look at what is the level of pollution in your city. Because for people, it's the health of their kids, of their parents, is all their capacity to live. Only that, which depends on the quality of the air. If you are in countries where the effect of climate change is now arriving. I'm thinking in the Philippines after the big hurricane, the typhoon they had years ago, or today the US and the Caribbean, in which one huge typhoons or cyclones, name them as you want, were destroying entire island. Those people realize that there is a common good, which is the climate, who has to be defended. And how to defend it without a logic of commons is difficult to imagine. Then that, and I'm going a little bit further to respect the time, but it's OK, I will be on time, explain why this logic of common it's so well-known and growing, both in the activist spheres and in the academic sphere. But after that, when you say that, you realize immediately that first at all, there is a lot of differences between commons. They are not at all the same in relation to their history, to their reality, to their scale. Some of them are very little. You know all Eleanor Ostrom, which is the only woman who got the Nobel Prize, and she got that because of her works on the commons. But what she was looking at as very little communities of farmers in Switzerland who bring their cattle, their cow in the higher field of the mountain, it's very little scale. When you look at Wikipedia, it's a worldwide scale. You have things who are totally different. You have a totally different relationship to the markets. The farmer in Switzerland, they want to sell their cheese because it's how they live. And the cooperative of workers wants also to sell what they are producing. At the opposite, other commons like Wikipedia or the free software are free. And you are not paying them, meaning that there is no exchange of money to use those kind of goods and realization. Other different, some commons are totally public. For example, the free software in his statute, in his definition, asked to the people, to the developers, to make public their realization, only to be understandable. But you have other commons who are less known, like, for example, the seeds. You know that for farmers, it's very important to control their seeds, to not let Monsanto or other multinational to control them. But when you discuss with farmers, they don't want those seeds to be too public. Because they said if they are too public, the state will steal them, or the big multinational will steal them. And the farmer said, what we want is to give it to the people we trust in, the people we are close to, the people who are like us, in which one we have a confident, trusting relationship. And here you can see that you have also some commons who are discreet, not totally public, not exactly secret, but in the middle. And those commons are part of the things who are more no-o than the no-ledge. And there are practices which exist a lot in the working class. For example, in the industrial chain, when a worker finds a way to save 2 seconds, which is for him a way to have a little rest, the first thing he wants to avoid is to tell to the engineer how he's able to cool down for 2 seconds, because it's the way for him to stop a little bit the exhausting work he's doing every day. And what he does is share his knowledge with his friend, with the other co-worker, but not at all the bosses. And it's a little bit like that the farmers are managing their relation with some commons like the seed, or this kind of agricultural practices. And you see, when you look at all those things, that the commons have so different realities that it's difficult to imagine that they are in the same movement. Working a little bit on that, my conclusion, and I think that probably is the same for Benjamin Coria and the others, is the only thing who are commons in the commons, you unify the commons, is that if you don't care about, they die. And that is something which is not so common in the economical field, for example, to say to something if you have to care about. And it's absolutely true. If you stop to care about local and archaic, in quotes, I put quotes everywhere, seed, they will disappear. The biodiversity will reduce very quickly. And to do that, you have to have farmers who are happy to have to look at particular species of chicken or particular seed of apple trees or pear tree or whatever. If they stop to do it, you will have only the industrial product with five or six variety of apple no more because they are the most easy to package for supermarkets, for example. And all this biodiversity depends of the caring of the farmer. But we could say the same about Wikipedia. If we all stop to write in Wikipedia, look in 20 years' time, Wikipedia will be obsolete. Who will read something which is 20 years old? Look at the old Britannica encyclopedia or the Universalis encyclopedia for the French speaker. Go to look at the one from the 70s and the 80s. Most of the articles are pointless today because the techniques and the knowledge changed a lot. And Wikipedia, if we stop to care about, will die. And those two examples of very different realization, Wikipedia and seeds, were one very local and secret or discreet, and the other one totally public and worldwide, show that the caring is the key element. And it's extremely important to realize that because that gives you also an indication of the trajectories of the commons. What I mean is that as all the human activities and human relationships, the commons are not eternal. And they have trajectories who could be going in a totally different way. A lot of commons become or are becoming multinational capitalist corporations. I give you one example which is the most famous. Look at agricultural commons. The farmers in a lot of countries, in particular in my country, in France, but also in New Zealand or Australia. I don't know if there are some people from New Zealand here. No? Okay, it's true also in the US. The farmers started to organize their production by cooperatives. And cooperatives of farmers were extremely important for a long time. It's not a new thing at all. It was a way for the farmers to work together, but also to be able to have an access to the market in a more efficient way, being in a cooperative than to be isolated in front of Walmart or a huge chain of supermarkets. And those cooperatives started to be extremely efficient, but at a level of efficiency in which one they are becoming huge multinational corporations. Look at the milk, for example, and all the product of the milk, the butter, the cream, it's a huge market. Today, China is importing yogurt and cheese and that by millions of tons. France is a big producer of those milky products. New Zealand is a huge producer, New Zealand even more probably than France today. And the cooperative of New Zealand, of farmers from New Zealand, is today one of the biggest companies in the world. In France, the same. If you are in a plane, you probably saw this little butter packet named President. You saw that they have also cheese and a lot of things named President. Now it's a private company owned by a family named Beignet, and the name of this company is Lactalis, whatever. But that was only from 1995. Before that, it was a cooperative of a farmer. But de facto, they were not caring. They let the management manage as they want. And this management believed that it was better to put the money in the financial market worldwide way. And those cooperatives became multinational corporations, no more than that. You could say the same about a lot of banks. You know that in a lot of countries, starting by the US, Australia, but true also in continental Europe, a lot of banks were mutual banks, union credit, union banks. Not private banks, but banks owned by the different people who put their money in. those people were not the poorest, because to be able to have your money in a bank account in the 19th century means that you were really in the bourgeoisie, because the workers had no banking system. They were paid in cash at this time. But those banks, even if they were owned by middle bourgeoisie, tell it quickly, I'm not doing a thesis on the banking system, were sort of common. But most of them today are the same that the Morgan Chase Bank or whatever. They are becoming multinational corporation as well. Meaning that the trajectory of the common is not because you have a common today that it will become genial and fantastic and great all the time being. You can have very bad trajectory of the commons. And each time you can realize that it's because people stop to care about and let, in particular in the big cooperative, in the agricultural sector, in the banking system, to the management. And the management took over de facto the reality of the ownership of those commons. But, and that will be my conclusion, and I finish with that. The big interest of the common, I told it a little bit before, is to have really the possibility to give to the people the possibility to be the actor of their own life and their own production. That's the key thing. The great thing about the common is that that gives to human community, who could be local human communities or worldwide, like the people who write in Wikipedia, the possibility to manage their own life and their own realization in this field of production. And at this level, I think it's extremely important because first of all, that shows that it's possible to do it without passing through big factories or through the state system. But that gives also example of what could be done in the state system as well as in the market. What I mean by that is that the market will probably always exist. I don't believe at all that one day the market will finish, the market of goods and services. The market exists long, long, long before capitalism, on the Roman time or the Greek domination of East Mediterranean. There was a market. People were exchanging goods and money. And that will probably be always the case. The same about the states. The states exist in Sumer, in the actual Iraq, or in China. 5,000 years ago, and they were important in different stage of history, and the state will be probably always there. But it's also important to have a way and a strategical approach to give power to people, what people name time to time the empowerment, even in the state level. And that doesn't mean that the state will disappear. But to give to the society the tool and the experience to emerge in the state system and to be able to defend their interests. If you are sick, for example, the IDS people were a good example on that. The movie was Gold Palm in Cannes was extremely important to show that the community of people sick, the IDS or other sickness, are able to defend themselves. And they have the right to claim for their right and to compete and to challenge the medical institution. Of course, we need good doctors, and a good doctor requires 10 years of university after the secondary school, no problem with that. But we have no reason to let them decide like kings or emperors. We need the society to be standing up, to be able to challenge their power and to have a discussion, a confrontation in a positive way. And in a lot of aspects of human activities in a very complex world, which is the one we are living in, we need this eruption of the society in different ways. And the logic of common is, for me, one of the most interesting to develop this approach of empowerment, to tell it very quickly. That's it. The rest, you have it in the text. What I explain here, you find a lot of my words in what I wrote, which is relatively logic, I hope at least. Then we can discuss, but you will have the floor, I suppose, because it's the time.
Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. First of all, thank you so much, Christopher, for this amazing paper and such an understandable paper and presentation. It was worth it. If like someone needs a basic understanding about commons, it was worth it. So it's me, Maria Mohammed, and my friend Yelena. We both are discussants today for the paper. I hope already all of you have been through the paper and you already know what was the paper about. This is the index of our presentation. The way we will move through our presentation, first of all, the idea of common has been very well explained by Christopher, but we just want to put a bit light on it and how the paper basically focuses upon and what is the point of focus of the paper. A bit history, then common versus public goods, capitalism, socialism debate, that is very common these days. Typology of commons, difficulty about the definition of commons, that how they are to be defined and how they are to be differentiated. Then we'll put forward some questions for you, a bit critique and positive aspects, because you are here to get some feedback, obviously, so we need to provide a positive feedback. So what are commons? The paper very well focuses upon the fact that we just need not to define the thing good or common good. We need to focus on the fact that what are commons and how they are different from common goods. So the social relationship that exists through the collective management of a common good or an element is basically common, and that is very important. I want to exemplify the village I belong in Pakistan. We have this system where two communities survive together. So in those two communities, one community being a bit less in number, water is basic, the common good, that is the entity for survival. And the land is agriculture and water is important for irrigation. So water being the common good is divided in a way that two communities, among the two communities, the community being smaller in number have water for 3 days, and the community being larger in number have water for 4 days. And no one actually tries to steal others' water, because water is a source of living for them and the source of life for them. So there are some unspoken rules and unspoken laws that exist, and that's what the social integration and social management comes in, that we call common. Basically, it's not just the good that is the water, but it's about the people and the social interaction that exists in the society through this common good that exists. Putting light on a bit of history, Christopher very well explained that what commons were, but commons were existing in the society since the existence of human society, since the existence of Adam. Like people were surviving in the form of communities and groups and moving from place to place in a way when there were natural resources. They used to use those natural resources in one place, and then they used to move to another place for consumption of natural resources to another place when the natural resources were depleted and consumed. In a way that even the women and land were not common or property of someone. Promiscuous sex was so common those days that even women were treated as common goods in the later society, in earlier societies. But the first form that came in the form of a written draft was Magna Carta in 1215. That came as a proper lawful form to be how commons are to be managed between farmers and the bourgeoisie, and then later on it was transformed with some charters and known as the Charter of Forest in 1225, and in 16th and 19th century later on further it was reformed in different ways, in different looking into different cultures and different social aspects. But what we are actually, we developing countries are thankful to British society. What they gave us was the bourgeoisie system, the feudal lord system, that still prevails in developing countries like Pakistan and India, and where the management of commons is a very big issue, because feudals still treat the farmers and the people working under them as the common rights are not that common, but they are not like well spoken rights, not well written rights, and that's how the feudal system prevails in the society. For that, this topic was very kind of an interest to me, because this is kind of a discrimination that prevails in the society. If you are not going to talk about these laws, if you are not going to talk about these rights, then the discrimination is going to prevail in the society till the end. Like, no development is going to take place without the effective use of these common goods. The paper very well explained an idea of differentiation between common goods and public goods, where public goods as defined are the non-exclusible and non-rivalrous group by Simmelson 1954 in his work, like the public lighting or the street lights, etc., whereas common goods are non-excludable, but they are rivalrous groups. As I very well explained, like if one community is going to get the water, the other community won't be able to get the water in the same days. This basically idea of mixing these both concepts came from the Tragedy of the Commons, a paper written by Hardin in 1654. Later on, Ostrom in her work very well explained in 2009 that there is a big difference between public goods and common goods and how commons are to be managed, and in her idea of governing the commons. This is a table that briefly explains about common goods, public goods, club goods, and different goods on the basis of being rivalrous and excludable in the society.
Okay. So in the paper, we have also seen many proposals and new adoptions of the idea how to manage different resources, because we all know that today, as it was mentioned before, there are especially natural-based resources that are very important. It's becoming more and more important how to manage these resources, such as climate, air, grounds, forests. So there are some new proposed ideas, and we're going towards that direction of accepting more and more the idea of commons, such as the Universal Declaration of the Common Goods of Humanity, which was made at the United Nations. And there are some ideas about the global public goods and common goods of humanity, but it was also mentioned in the paper, and some of us learned that in different classes. These ideas are a bit of mixture between public and common goods, which has to be distinguished, which we are really think that it's a positive side that paper did stress the difference between something that's publicly opened and then it's commons. You will see it later, but it's really important to stress on this difference. As this debate is the mentioned debate between capitalism and socialism, as people associate everything in capitalism with exclusive private rights, which we are facing especially in Europe but everywhere today, everything is privatized, and within it gets to be mostly monopolized with multinational companies. As far as we have seen in USSR and some other countries, when there was a socialism and where everything was owned and planned by a state, that also didn't properly work. So this debate starting between is something, as our professor Corian said, zero or one, only private or only public, as there is, if you think better on it, there is a big spectrum things in between, and commons are one of these things that are in between private and public. So as it said, the commons as an idea are in relation between public and private. They are not strictly binary, meaning that there are companies today who are managing, for instance, if you take a maps, there are private companies, completely private, who are like Google, that have their own Google Maps. They kind of have a monopoly on it, but they are allowing a public use of it. They are not commons. These are public, these are private companies, but allowing public to use as something they produce. As far as we have also a situation where there is a company like French National Geographic Institute that also provided maps, but lost competition because it was no longer able to sell the maps, because now Google makes it public and free for everyone. And then there is a third idea of the OpenStreetMaps. There is more an idea and movement towards making the maps like a common, meaning that Google has a monopoly over changing those maps. Everybody can use it, but no one can change them. As in OpenStreetMaps, the idea is that everybody can also, they're editable. So editable. Everybody can also change the map. So it become closer to the commons. To get the idea how difficult it is to define commons and why they are such a open idea, something that's sometimes called utilitaristic or like something that it's not possible. It's because they are they involve a lot of cooperation, and they are also a social relation. There is a social relation included. Societies are different with their different rules, and one of the main critics based on the Ostrom work that was made, which I particularly don't see the importance on, but critics did criticize Ostrom's work on, is that she didn't particularly in her work considered also endogenous people, as maybe some of them and their societies don't really want to manage nature. Maybe they consider themselves as a part of nature which should be just used. But this is just to show how different the concept of commons is, that societies are different. It has to be managed in different ways and involves cooperation, a constant interaction, and they really evolve over time. So interesting example of it can be, as I come from a country that was part of Yugoslavia. We didn't had a particularly idea as very such as USSR had, which many people think that Yugoslavia had the same system, which it really didn't. As the after the Second World War, Yugoslavian economists and leaders saw that USSR model doesn't really function as the communistic way. So we had a social experiment in a way. They started basics of something that is called self-managed socialism. And we had something called social property. It's really close to it is commons in a way, but it is not about the naturally based resources, which is mostly done in work of the Ostrom. This was mostly also about debate of private versus public. How was this divided? Basically, in Yugoslavia, there were a lot of companies that were owned by a state. But state was not directly the only owner. Workers had their own feeling and their own rights in it. There were also different councils of workers, and the workers had the feeling that they belong to it, and they are also partly owners. Different positions of workers had different benefits and different owners, and the state still had its own stake in it, its own way to manage and get the rules, as the state proposed some directors. Why people also come back to Harding's idea of tragedy of the commons and mix them with these socialism ideas is that Yugoslavian system also failed. But basically it didn't fail because of the idea of commons. It failed because it was purely managed, because state had a monopoly on the politics. And this incorporated a lot in these things. But social regimes and social property didn't really failed. This is a very good example to see how commons can be effective, even including something private, like building different buildings and apartments. As if you go to Belgrade, which was a capital of Yugoslavia and all of these countries, you will still see that 90% of population lives in the apartments that were given and made by this social experiment. Even my family lives in one of these apartments, which was given to workers as their right, because they were workers and working within the company. So they didn't feel that they just are open source, using open source. They felt that they own something. And it will, I think it's really important to stress the Yugoslavian example and difference between the USSR, as our nation had the feeling that also this will stay to their, not every resources, of course, as Ostrom says that their resources, some resources should be only publicly managed, and some should be exclusive public rights, but some could be managed very well in also common way. Okay, so back to the some new ideas and some where are we moving today. It was mentioned that in the area of software, it was created, that is called Free Software Foundation, and the general public license. It means that instead of having softwares that are publicly open to everyone, and then companies such as Apple and Microsoft, as it was mentioned, can make patents on them and then make them private. This general public license allows everyone to use patents and anything that is under there, but if they use them for their own and they change them, they have to put them back under the general public license. So it's kind of innovation that it's a something is common but not can be used in a to get to become only exclusive public exclusive right, because this in a way started, this is important debate which we have seen, only going towards the exclusive rights started in a way decreasing our development. And if you take example of academy, as we saw that there was first of all, there was the idea of Creative Commons, which was the idea of starting also to help academics to protect their work. But it was mentioned, the academics mostly do it for the, they have their own salary and they don't benefit of it. So there was a starting of, in Budapest, Open Access Initiative, which they can publish their own work for free and everybody can access much easier to the resources to get developing process easier. So as it was mentioned, how difficult of the definition in general are the commons, we can, if we followed Awesome's work, she did manage to work on the different, she worked on naturally based resources, but she did manage to get some ideas of the how to manage and some basic rules, eight or different, if I remember, different rules of the polycystic management cycle. But it's really difficult to put them in one category because it's such a broad thing. But we have seen the movements going towards this idea more, such as we had wars in Bolivia, which people were fighting against the privatization. And it was a case in Italy, which people said that, for instance, for water is a very good example of this, that they said that water definitely is common good, that it should be common, not privatized. And as it was mentioned, that the climate and such a resources as air should be collectively managed on planetary level, because if we don't do that, if we just use exclusive public rights or open public resources, if we open them, it will get into big problems. So also there is a big importance, as Ostrom manages that, Ostrom mentions that commons should be managed in a way of implementing democracy. But then there is a big question, how do we implement this democracy and how do we take care of these resources, as it was difficult. And there is example in a paper of the Brazil, which they tried to, with the budgets, they tried to implement good ideas, but the common to be properly managed doesn't mean just changing the political system. It means also changing a lot of the other stuff and social relations. So the commons involved participation and real involvement, not merely changing the structures or power. And internet is a good example of the common that actually went way beyond the early initiative and went beyond now. The entire world develops and uses internet such as in a way of common goods. As it was mentioned, that we are moving now towards the in new era, more towards the more and more ideas of commons, that now we have incorporated in a French constitution from 2005 the rights to live in healthy and ecologically balanced environments. We have a universal declaration of rights of Mother Earth that was proposed to in United Nations. We are promoting now more and more, we're seeing the promotion of social values and sharing. And now, as it was mentioned, there are more and more creations of unions. Even the private corporations are getting into the unions. This is not a proper idea, a proper definition. They're not typically commons, but they are something going more and more into the corporations. And we have new free alternatives that, for instance, free programmers, cooperative platforms based on exchange and non-profit ideas. In paper is really good explained that a circular economy that we have today, it's not the same as the idea of commons, but it is idea of sharing, of recycling and shorter circuits between producers and consumers, which today we have platforms that facilitate this sharing. And we have different movements such as in Dignitas and Occupy, which basically work on three principles. Whoever wants, it's able to participate. It's participation and decisions are adopted by consensus, and they are also socialized at the broadest local level. Okay, and we will mention also some important debates that were mentioned in the paper, which we all have to think about, especially when we think about commons. How far can we go with commons? As there are some ideas that if everything is owned by a state, can we also see a state as a one private owner? So in which way we need to manage commons? How much power should we give to the state? Is it possible to commonize the state? Or we always need involvement of a state, and do we need it? And how to properly implement the idea of commons in different ideas, in different social regimes? And what is the most appropriate way of managing this, especially something that Ostrom calls common pool resources, that are climate, oceans, and glaciers, and also how to implement and what is real democracy when it's about commons?
A paper very well explained a lot of areas, but a few areas were literally just overshadowed in a way that needs to be, we just want to put a bit stress on them. The ownership rights. If we deal with commons, it's very important that in the paper, internet and other resources like Facebook, etc., were known as they are kind of moving towards the common resource circle. But we still need to know that these resources are still owned by some company that has ownership right and a monopoly over them. So they are not basically, they for us, if we review the literature through Ostrom's point of view, it doesn't fall under the idea of commons as such. With that, if we, in this globalized world, if we move back to the idea of commons, do you think it's a convenient idea of moving back to this idea of commons? With that, if we talk about these, because most of the focus of the paper was on indigenous people, indigenous society, and then how commons are managed by these indigenous people. And in academia, a lot of examples are taken from the indigenous communities that are living all around the world. But the way of management of commons by them and implementation of that in this globalized and not actually globalized but internationalized world politically and resourcefully, do you think it's easier to do that? And like we will actually want you to put a bit light on them. And then there were literally, the paper was enlightening, of course, the history and the social relationships that were described were like very easily understandable for a person who is reading for the first time what commons are. It was very well written. The conclusions that were drawn were very positive. The paper itself has an opportunistic and an optimistic view that showed that actually if you are going to do that, like it was kind of convincing that if we are going to move towards commons, okay, there is a positive thing that we are going to move towards. Paper very well supported Ostrom's academic work and very well appreciates that. So both of us actually love Ostrom's work, and we well studied it, so we were like kind of very into it. And the idea of circular economies, collaborative economies, governance and politics and relating it to commons was kind of a new thing that has never been done, I think, in academia, and that was a really new thing. So thank you so much for your presentation, and thank you so much for your attention and listening. This is the list of references and bibliography if someone wants to go through it.
I think the good thing is to have a discussion with all of you. Of course, I will be very brief. I really appreciate your common work, but your presentation. And what I really appreciate the most is the fact that you talk about your countries and your realities, both Pakistan and also, and I think it's a very interesting remark that Yugoslavia is not, and was not, it's another time, was not USSR. And this experience of self-government in Yugoslavia, with all the limits you described well, was a very inspiring issue, as well as the Pakistanese one. Now, thanks a lot for that. In what you said, I agree with most. I have a little issue I wanted to precise, which is the reference to Samuelson. which is a discussion, I didn't present it, it's a little bit in the paper, if you read it, which is the difference between the economical view on the commons and the sociological view on the commons. Historically, Samuelson was the one who defined what's a public good. Not exactly the commons, but more public good. And the explanation you gave was the good one. It was not excludable and without rivalry, the term. And the public lightning, but also the Hertzian, the RTV, also the television, is also a good example of that. You know probably those theories. It's difficult to articulate that with the commons, because in the commons you have different kind of property and property right. For example, the idea that the commons are not rivalty, not excludable, what you explain. It's true for some of them. Fishing, very good example. Some of the commons are not excludable, meaning that it's difficult for a fisher to block the possibility for another fisher to take the fish. Okay, that we can understand it. But at the same time, in some common, there are a possibility of exclude other people. When Eleanor Ostrom talked about the farmer who put their cows during summer in the height of the mountain, not all farmers can go there. Only the farmers who are part of the community who have an access to this mountain. Meaning that according to the different kind of common with all the diversity, and you were right to focus on this diversity, you have different relations to property. Some of them are not excludable, like the fishing. Others are excludable, and others are totally open to everyone, like Wikipedia or the internet, meaning that you cannot put the commons in one of the categories, if you want. Okay, that was to precise that. And which is a little bit your first issue in the critique. It's one of the first issues. The commons can be also very private in a way. I will tell you a small thing which could happen in Paris and did happen, in fact. One of the commons which is very popular in this city is what we name the shared garden, meaning that instead of having public garden organized by the municipality, you have little garden in which when people, the neighbors of place, can grow up potatoes, vegetables, fruits, whatever they want. It's very nice. Very nice. And we have that in other cities. Paris is not the only one. But we have now a new reality in Paris, which are all the refugees. And of course, a lot of them, and I saw that in the 10th district close to Gare de l'Est, they have no place to sleep. And often they go to those kind of garden. And what to do in this case? For me, I think the most important is the human being and the possibility for the refugees to have a place to sleep. But at the same time, the commoners can say, hey, no, not at all. It's our garden, and we want to defend it. You see the kind of contradiction who can happen, and which is the problem of property. Several commons are privately defined, meaning that there is a sort of boundary around. It's the case of the Ostrom commons, which she wrote about in Switzerland. It's the case of the cooperative. The cooperative are not owned by the rest of the world. They are owned by the worker who work in. Even in Yugoslavia, what you say about your parents and their friends, is only the workers of this kind of factory who had the access of those flats, which is normal as those commons are working. But that could be a problem. Only to know it. The indigenous society, globalized world, it's a real issue, but I think that today people recognize and acknowledge the importance of defending the indigenous rights. It's something which is quite challenging, because when I spoke about the different history of common and the different generation of common, the farmers in the 12th century or 13th century, the cooperative and so on, I was very brief. But when you read what the socialists of the 19th century were writing, in particular Karl Marx, he said that capitalism had a big positive impact, which is to dissolve all the rules of the past, who were seen by Marx and all the other socialists, it was not only the case of Marx, as a sort of heavy heritage, heavy legacy from the past we have to finish with. Of course, for him, this legacy from the past, this history from the past, was mainly the royalty, the feudal system, the landlord, and I totally understand why he wanted to be rid of that. But also they wanted to be rid of this kind of particular social relationship who are the commons. And we can see that in Latin America. I don't know if some of you come from Latin America in the room. Yeah. Yeah, you are several. You know all the story of Marti, Bolivar, and all the revolutionary, if you want. Hein? But, generally, those wars, because they were also civil wars, hein, in which when the people wanted the freedom of the Latin American countries were named the Creole Revolution against the Spanish, who were the white people coming from Spain and being the settlers de facto. But there was a third actor in a lot of those wars, the indigenous people. And those indigenous people had specific rights and specific traditions, like the Ejido I was talking about in Mexico. And those things were not at all what Bolivar and Marti were defending, because Bolivar and Marti were coming like Karl Marx from the Enlightenment period, and he was really he had in mind to finish with all those vieilleries, old things, because what they believe in, Marti or Bolivar, but Marx the same, that what's important is to give freedom to individuals, and all those old relationships were not what they defended. And we had at the opposite a strange counter alliance, if you want, where the Spanish vice king and all the rest of the colonial power were giving to the indigenous their right to try to convince them that to be with them against the revolutionary. If you want, we had a little bit the same in France, in all these things were named the Chouannerie, which was the west part of France, refusing the French Revolution. It was a mix of nobles who didn't want to give up their power at this time of revolution, but also farmers were defending their tradition, their history. And we have all these problems with indigenous people. In the case of Latin America, it was a complex issue during the Civil War, the Bolivar, and so on. And it's why I am focusing here in today, because if you look at this 19th century, those people from Bolivar to Karl Marx in very different contexts and very different continent were both the irritant of the Enlightenment, and they wanted to dissolve all these old story. And that's what I wanted to say to add to your critics. That's it, but the best is to give you the floor. Who wants to talk? Start first, you are two. You need the mic or not? What do we do?
Yeah, so Benedict from option B. Thank you again for you.
And where are you from?
I'm German.
Ah.
Yeah. So thank you again for coming and for the very interesting talk. I have a question or a remark or both. One of the most important forms of commons nowadays is software. I think we can all agree on that. I'm just not really sure anymore we can actually call it commons, because Wikipedia, that's clear. But if we look at the really most impactful forms of open source software, example would be Android, I think, as the best example. It is essentially, in a weird way, privately owned, right? It is open source, but then there are the add-ons which are proprietary,
right,
and enable Google to then make money by collecting the data. So it is this kind of weird form where it is a common, but maybe a common for multinational corporations and not so much for us anymore. Would I be correct with this observation?
Yeah, I can answer. You are totally right. Totally right. And it's one of the difficulty of those concepts. But we have to acknowledge that it's also true for the public sector. The public sector is seen as very different than the private sector. But look at the SNCF, French public railway. more and more their practices are close to the corporations and the private sector. More and more they are using the management tradition of the private sector. And what we can see of interpenetration between capitalist corporation and public sector, it's also true with the free software. And you are totally right. In the free software, first you have not only nice commoners who are individual developers who in the evening after their work are doing a little bit of code for the common good. Those people exist, of course, and thanks, they are there. But look at OpenOffice. You know OpenOffice is the free software competitor to Microsoft Office. But the main contributors to OpenOffice are IBM and Sun Microsystems. And both of them are not nice NGOs. They are multinational corporations. Why they do that? Because they have not the resources and they think it's more economical to do it in free software than to try to do an alternative, a corporate alternative to Microsoft Office. As simple as that. It's a way for them to attack Microsoft. In the game and in the war the different corporations are having among themselves, they use this tool to weaken Microsoft. Meaning that you have a lot of actors who have a lot of crazy or bizarre or strange for observer like us game, like IBM and Sun Microsystems. And about Android, you are totally right. It's a free software. Google was built through and defend the free software, but at the same time, they privatized just a little bit to be able to get a lot of benefits from, in particular the data. No, I totally agree. And we will find that in a lot of aspects. That's why this idea of caring is important. Because if the communities of free software developers are able to be strict on, and I know that, for example, in the mobile phone industry, some free software developers, they didn't win until now, were wanting to develop Linux. Because you know that Android comes from Linux. The root of Android is, you know, everyone knows Linux. At the beginning, what Google did is to use the Linux roots to create Android. And some developers want to use a real free software Linux to put in the mobile phone instead of Android for this reason. And I think it's a good alternative. I don't know if they will succeed, but it's what they want to do. But maybe we can go like that because of the mic. You and we pass. And it's okay for you?
I'm Luisa from Option A.
What country?
Sorry?
What's your country?
Brazil.
Okay.
I'd just like to know what is your opinion about commonizing big data?
Commonizing?
Big data.
Yeah.
Especially in regard to the provision of public services.
Mm-hmm. I think we should do that, but there is even in the database a free patent. You know that database can be patented. If you create a database, you can put a patent. I'm not telling that it's nice, but legally you can do that. For example, you know all the phone the phone book. You have all the phone in the old time. Today there is less and less. What's the name? En français on dit un annuaire. You know the book.
Yeah.
The book with the, that it's a private. Those databases are privately owned by the telecom company. And you cannot use them as you want. And it's true that using the open source or free software like the GPL or the Creative Commons, you can patent the database as a common. And I think in several of them, it's a good idea. The problem of those big data is you have a lot of information who are a real problem for privacy. And the difficulty is to be sure that in the big data, what you put as public and common are something who are not creating more difficulties in privacy level, which is the case of a lot of those big data things. What Google is collecting, it's a huge risk for privacy. We have to know that some of other databases are not a problem. For example, I don't know if the post office gives you all the addresses of the little yellow box where you can put your letter, that's no problem at all to use it as a public good. Today there is a, a movement in different states, and I suppose that Brazil are doing it, but it's the case in the US, in France, in Britain, to have what they name open data. Open data is a sort of common good. And if you look, for example, at France, that will give you an example. I don't know about the other countries. What I recommend for you, have a look to this website named data.gouv.fr. That's the French website where you will find all the open database. And they put in only the database who are open, meaning commons in this case, and because it's totally open to everyone, and who are not problematic at privacy level. You have not your health data, for example.
Sorry, can I continue?
Yeah.
But how do you think that it could be regulated? And also, how do you think that private organizations could be motivated to offer this kind of data for the public benefit? These monopolies of data, how could they be motivated to offer this data?
You have other question or? No, but I can answer to the second one. No, I think that here, on these things, is data.gouv.fr. You have probably that in Brazil. I'm sure that in the US, I'm sure in Germany, in Britain, they have that as well. There are data coming from the public sector. You have transport information, post office information. All the public companies have to put their data here. Also, the state administration has to put their data here. The data is not problematic for privacy, of course. About private companies, today, and it's a problem in my opinion, there is no rule. The only rule is the control of the data, who could be a problem for privacy. We have in France, but I'm sure you have it in Brazil as well, something named the CNIL, which is the Commission Nationale Informatique et Liberté, could be translated as the National Commission on Computing System and Freedom, which is a way for the state. It's a specific body which is independent from the state, even if it's paid by the state, to control the respect of privacy by private companies when they create databases. But then a lot of those databases could be very useful for everyone. Some of them, because of their business, open their data. You know, maybe this acronym, Application Programming Interface. Application Programming Interface, the most well-known, is the Google API to give access to the developer to the Google Map. If you create a website, if you want a map in, you can put the Google Map through the API of Google. And several companies, in particular from the Silicon Valley culture, are putting in public, are giving access to their database. You all know eBay, for example, where you can sell and buy things. They open, through a specific API, their database. But if they do it, it's for the same reason than Google. Is because it's good for their business. What eBay wants is to increase the number of goods who are exchanged between people. And each time you are buying something on eBay or putting something on eBay, eBay gets 1 or 2%. And that's why they open their database. But I think it could be better if we could oblige the private company to open their database in a more transparent way. We can do all this tour, and we'll finish by you.
My name is Victoria. Thank you for your presentation. Victoria from Option A.
Louder.
Victoria.
And where are you from?
I'm from Russia.
Russia.
I would like you to ask about the ways of regulation of common goods, especially resources which we consider open pool resources. If we talk about regulation, the easiest way and the most famous solution, I think, for this is just limiting an access. For example, if we talk about lakes, rivers, and to in order to avoid overuse of these resources, we just limit some people from participation. Sometimes governmental structures are invited to participate, so to put some regulations on. I would like you to ask about other solutions to these problems. What can be done, and if nowadays this problem of climate change and overuse of resources is so popular, what are other solutions of which are like on the plate now?
Okay, if I understood well, you ask what kind of rules could
regulations of overuse, yes.
Yeah, one of the difficulty, but it's starting, is to give limit to property rights. You know that the Enlightenment, which is all the modernity and the world we are living in, was based in several values, and one of the values, it's Locke who wrote it in England 300 years ago, is that you have to have an exclusive property of things. Of course, nothing is totally exclusive today, and it's a good thing, but you have this idea that when you own something, you can exclude the others from this property because it's your property, and you can have an absolute right on the things you are owning. When I said absolute right, now it's more and more discutable because if you put a lot of risk for the environment, the state can put regulation, it's a good thing. But historically, capitalism was based on that. When the commons was at the opposite on the idea of the separation of different kind of right about things, look again at the forest and the Carta Magna of the forest, your friends were putting the reference on. There was a specific right, for example, for hunting, to kill animals, given to the landlord. But other kind of right was given to the people who took wood to eat their house or to cook their food. And we could imagine things like that, which is a little bit the case in, for example, in national parks. If you go to a national park, it's generally state-owned. But time to time, and I hope it will be the case in most of the situation, they allowed indigenous people to live there and to have their own activity, but as a usage, not as a property. And they allowed you to be a tourist and to go to holidays, but generally you cannot camp there. You have to go during the day and no more to not have an over-exploitation of the natural resources. And I think it's a good way, by separating the different kind of ownership, to not give to specific entity the absolute ownership, but to be able to have usage for that, in a way in which when you can regulate the impact on the environment. And of course, the regulation of national parks are different from one country to another, or to the access of the river and the lake, but thinking like that, you can find good solution, in my opinion at least. Climate change is another issue. Because climate change, it's really a worldwide challenge, maybe the most important that humanity has to face today, when you look at the consequences at all the level. And I think that we have to have both a mobilization of the society in general, us, but also the companies in which one we are working. But we need also to have strict regulation from the states. And I really believe that, for example, to limit the consumption of petrol in cars, all those things are absolutely key if we want to fight against the increase of green gas and to have regulation on the building process to avoid to spend an incredible amount of carbon gas only to heat the houses. In Russia, you know this problem. You need a lot of regulation like that. And it's done partially. Each country does different kind of rules, but it's absolutely key for the future of humanity, in my opinion.
Yes, absolutely. But also there is a question of bureaucratization. Like, if
of bureaucratization, if we invite governmental structure, and also some cases of corrupted governments, and for example, lobbying, which can really prevent from putting forward such initiatives.
No, you are right about the corruption. Bureaucratization, not so much. It's only a rule. If you build a building, you have to have isolation. That's it. And that doesn't mean that you need to create a lot of bureaucracy for that. Because we have already a regulation. You cannot build a building like that without following rules, for example, for security. If there is a fire or whatever, you have a lot of rules. And in other countries, against the earthquake, you have rules everywhere. We are not the same in Japan or Mexico because you have a huge amount of earthquake. You don't have that probably in Russia or here, neither. It's not the same rule, but we have a lot of rules for fire. We have to have rules for greenhouse emission to limit them.
Hello, I'm Leila from Argentina, option C. Thank you very much for your presentation. It's always encouraging to hear someone who is at the same time in the academic field, but especially an activist and defined himself as such. My question is a bit connected with this last one, because I do understand how crucial can it be to communalize even the state, but at the same time, I understand it's essential to go back to a posture where the state becomes again a very important actor. I think you are in a way talking of ecosystems, and I see that. But for example, in innovation, you come from a company where you have, as you said, a very small, even for a very important company, a very small area of R&D. So for example, in that area, investment for innovation, how do you see the role of the state and commons interacting so as to promote more innovation for issues such as climate change? Thank you.
Mm-hmm. It's a huge topic. Honestly, the problem of innovation is that innovation can come from everywhere. You had in the digital world a lot of bottom-up innovations. Look at Wikipedia, it's one example, but you have a lot of others. The blogs were created by a student who was in love with his partner and he wanted to have a refreshment of the pages. You have the Wi-Fi, the Wi-Fi. It was set up by activists in Seattle after 2000 because the company at this time didn't want to develop this technology. They preferred to have the 3G or the 4G because you get money for a telecommunication company when you buy and you sell 3G and 4G. And the computing and industry wanted to develop only the what we name the Bluetooth because it's more short run. And activists were really creating this innovation everyone is using today. Everyone uses Wi-Fi everywhere on the planet, not only here. All those things were bottom-up innovation. They were not exactly commons, but they were bottom-up innovation. But a lot of them, and not only in the digital world, can be commons like Wikipedia. Not all are, but a lot of them can be. And there is also, in this kind of sharing economy, even if it's not exactly the common, you have a lot of people who are thinking that it's possible to have free patent, even for hardwares. You have people who believe that, because also of the, if we come back to the climate change, all the solar panel industry and so on, they live on patents. And the idea to open those patents as a sort of common good for humanity, to go faster in the struggle against climate change, it's also a good idea. And it's more and more popular. And you have a more and more of movement pushing on this way. As the civil society was able to do it in the drugs against AIDS. It was AIDS. There was a big fight in the 90s because the first drugs, the three therapies against AIDS, were extremely expensive and the drugs company wanted to get as much money as they could. And it was a big, big, big fight by NGOs like Médecins Sans Frontières and NGOs like that to oblige the companies to free their patents to become common good. Mm-hmm.
Hi, my name is Eric from Option A, and I'm from the Philippines. And in our country, the idea that you're espousing this afternoon is something that we find common in the rural areas. Mm-hmm. But one but aside from the benefits that you've mentioned, and I think how it's in a good model between statism and corporatism, one thing that I wanted to ask you is, when we push for commons, especially among communities, they tend to acquire a very localized nature, wherein a lot of the concerns tend to be focused on the locality. And I guess the question there is, how do you encourage those communities to adopt a viewpoint that goes beyond their local concerns? Just one more comment. I think it was nice when you mentioned about the recognition of the, existence of the market and of corporations. Oh, sorry, the state.
Both, market and state.
Right, exactly. Because what I think would be appropriate would really just to, I guess that's the question that I wanted to post really, is how do you translate those local concerns into something that's compatible with a broader area of, effect.
Yeah. No, it's one of the main challenges, is the problem of scale. You explain it when you talk about water. The scale is a huge problem because the most of the commons historically were limited. And it's true that for human community, it's more easy when you have a little group. It's more easy for you to manage your group of students than if you were 500 or 5,000, for example. You know that the Greeks, on the ancient time, and the Pericles time, wanted to limit the size of the city because it was difficult to manage if it's too big. And on the common, you have the same problem. A local commons, when it's little, it's easy. Easy. Could be problematic, but globally it's easy. More the scale is enlarging, more is difficult. For example, in this city, because the left is still managing Paris, there was a municipalization of the water system, was privatized in the past. And the idea of the person, I know the person in the municipality council who was in charge of that, was to do it as a common. But how to have a common in a city of 3 million of people, of water? What kind of relationship with the whole basin? Because the Seine is a huge river, and we have probably like 15 million of people who are depending on this water system. How to do it as a common? It was the same challenge in Bolivia, in Italy, and so on. There is no good solution until now. What was done in Paris is de facto to have a municipal management, which is a sort of state management, which is good, it's okay, but the water is good, you can drink it, but it's not really an empowerment of individuals. Of course, it's not corporation, it's a municipality, but it's managed by the municipality.
And I mean, just to add to that, I mean, for these local communities, for example, the topic of climate change or the sustainable ecosystem, those are too abstract for your local communities. So in a sense, for a community of 30 people that's, let's say, managing an aquatic resource, how do you make them realize that what they're doing affects billions of people, that it's leading to climate change that affects the entire world? I mean, those kinds of abstractions, how do you bring that into their level so that those people realize the responsibility that they have in their hands?
Yeah, I think I'm maybe more optimistic than you, because I think that there are a lot of ways to do it. For example, the farmers, the little one, have now a huge international unions named Via Campesina, which is a huge union in which when you have 300 million of people who are part of true local branches, and those branches are able to have congress meeting in which one they talk about. And when you look at, if you go to Via Campesina, it's in Spanish at the origin, but you can look at their website, and they are really very involved in the struggles against climate change, in favor of food sovereignty, a lot of concepts. And a lot of small communities are more and more learning, not through the state or through the academic, but through their peers, the people who are like them. And this direct exchange between farmer or between fisher folks, you have a lot in Pakistan of fisher activist groups, same in Philippines, you will have a fisher folks congress soon in Manila, and you have a lot of things like that to show that it's possible to have a direct relationship between fishers, between farmers, between to talk about their concern, and generally they are quite good in understanding the big challenges like climate change and others.
Thank you.
Ettore Gallo, option B, I'm Italian. So thank you for the presentation. I really appreciated your approach to of maintaining both the academic and political, the activist side. So I will try to do the same in my common question. So I, on the general level, I could agree that the commons may constitute an alternative to capitalism, but what I think it's somehow disregarded is that the approach doesn't really consider what are the power relations and the relations of production in a capitalist mode of production. And so I don't see how can be possible to move within a commonification in a system that remains capitalist. And so, I mean, I don't think that it's possible to shift the relations of production without shifting the relations of power and vice versa. So my question would be why the capitalist class should allow to increase in the economic weight of commons in the economy without reacting. And like moving more on the political level, I guess that the aim of the of commons of moving beyond capitalism is to build a society like Bertolt Brecht defined, the simplicity that is hard, that is difficult to make. But okay, and to do so, do you think that the role of social movements can be enough? Because especially after the complete failure of the last years, and I refer mainly to Genova 2001. And after that, I think that don't you think it could be better to structure more the political organization like a party or a political structure that can pose at the center of the attention the seizure of power.
Mm-hmm. No, I agree with you. What I was presenting here is the approach of the commons. I didn't talk about the state, except to say that commons are an alternative both to statism and to capitalism. But of course, the regime in which one country is established has a huge impact of the trajectories of the different social relationships and actors, in particular the commons. That's why I was giving the example of this cooperative of farmers who became very easily, or the credit unions, meaning the banks, were very quickly and simply integrated in the capitalist system, totally integrated. And that showed that one of the strengths of capitalism is not only to resist and to defend itself, but is to co-opt and integrate and transform. It does it from the beginning. The plasticity and the flexibility of capitalism is one of these most important characteristics. And it's true also about the trajectory of the commons and the way in which one can integrate easily. It was the example I gave in my short presentation. And it's absolutely true, I agree with you, that if we want to believe and to think that one day the commons will be at the earth, at the heart, and at the center of a new social relation system, a global system, that need a political transformation and a transformation of the power relationship. And that's politics. At this level, I think that you need to have a relationship between movement, commons, and political structure. And that happened today. I know that Italy is complicated. I'm not entering into Italian politics, which is one of the most complicated today in Europe. But look, for example, at Spain. In the cities of Spain, like Barcelona, I'm not talking about the Catalonia independence movement, it's another thing, but look at the municipality. The name of the movement who won the municipality at the last election is Barcelona and Comune. Barcelona in common, it's a common. And Ada Colau come both from the social movement because he was one of the responsible of the movement was fighting for housing to help the people who are losing their house through the huge crisis Spain knew after 2011. But also a big movement of the common. Barcelona is really at the avant-garde in Europe of those movements and common. And the fact to translate that in politics, meaning the capacity to take the power in a municipality, it's not the Spain in general, that shows that it's possible. And I think that it's one of the challenges for the new radical left, because you have everywhere in Europe, the same in North America, new radical left, very diverse. Look at Syriza in Greece, Podemos in Spain, look at Jeremy Corbyn in Great Britain, France Insoumise for part here in France. All those things are different from one to the others, but one of their challenges is what model for society they are proposing. And this issue of common is more and more discussed.
Yeah, okay, just a comment. I will say that, it's the idea of commons, the approach can help in taking the power in small in municipalities, also in big cities like Barcelona, but it's I don't know if it's really possible to take the power on the national level without structured political organization.
But it's a Barcelona Comun, it's a party. It's a party movement, it's a movement party, it's but it's a political organization.
Yeah, it's the same in Italy with Naples, but it cannot become the become the national an example for the for Italy as a whole. Mm-hmm.
If I can add just a little comment, you mentioned the case of... You said in your examples the case of Cochabamba in Bolivia. And for me, it's a very interesting case because Evo Morales, the current president of Bolivia, as you know, he started from a social movement, and they were able to send presidents home 2-3 times, and then they realized, okay, we have the power to make them go home, but then the next one is doing the same thing with natural resources, but with any important issue. So they finally decided to build a political party. And they are still in power, and they are one of the only governments of the last decade that still remains. Because in a way, with many tensions, of course, with civil society, they have been able to maintain themselves as a social movement, as a political party, but at the same time to argue and to have a fight with power relations, as you mentioned. So I think that's an inspiring story to look at. Thank you.
Hey. Good example. But it's not simple, if you enter in the Bolivian history.
Thank you. My name is Akonde Manuel. I'm option A. I want to ask about...
And what country?
Nigeria.
Nigeria.
I want to know about your view on if the management of commons... especially in the digital arena, could lead to the emergence of new systems of capitalism in the Cathedral and Badra and the Bazaar. The author treated about he was talking about originator bias that originator bias, the key players that manage commons, for example the lost leader or the would get frosting, that's Red Hat or Netscape, that they had some incentives in marketing some of the services for corporate product could lead to the new monopolist in the market of commons management, which is the software. What's your opinion on this?
No, if I understood well, you were talking about Red Hat. Red Hat is the most important North American company who are selling free software services. Free software services is, for example, you are a company, whatever the company you are, you want to pass from Microsoft Office to Open Office. but you have to train all your staff, your employees, and to adapt OpenOffice to the reality of your organization in your company, and you ask to Red Hat to help you to do that. And they have a de facto a sort of monopoly, you are right. But Red Hat is a capitalist company, even if they do time to time good things. For example, the boss of Red Hat was the one who paid the development of the Creative Commons. He paid Lawrence Lessig during 1.5 years with the staff to write all the Creative Commons patent, which is a specific patent, meaning that they can do good jobs. But it's a capitalist company. What I am more interested in the digital commons is the management of the digital commons, in particular the management of the internet and the management of Wikipedia. It's very interesting. Because it's not at all the classic democracy. There is a formula given by David Dana Clark, who was really the boss of the technical body of the internet in the 80s. He said, we reject kings. Okay, no problem in France, the two. We cut the head of the last one. We reject kings, president, and voting. They reject the principle of vote, which is quite challenging. And they said, we believe in running code, meaning the capacity of having a good software, and rough consensus which is not really well finished. And the internet works like that. They have a body named the IETF, the Internet Engineering Task Force, which is the place where they decide all the protocol of the internet, the HTTP for the web and all those things were decided inside the IETF. And everyone can come. You can be a corporation, a state, an NGO, or an individual, a research center, whatever you want, and you work by working group, and every decision has to be taken at a consensual level. And that works. That shows that it's possible to have different way of democratic rules. Wikipedia, the same. It's a little bit different, Wikipedia, but you know that we have, probably several of you do that as well, several million to contribute to Wikipedia, to write, I don't know, to change comma or whatever, or to write an article. But we have very few people, I suppose no one here is part of the management of Wikipedia. But it's open to everyone. And whatever is your mother tongue, you can be Italian, Urdu, Spanish, or whatever, you can manage Wikipedia. And the rules they have are extremely interesting because it's a form of democracy when you push the decision to the extremity. You avoid to concentrate the power and you ask to the people to resolve the problem at their level, at their scale. And we have to learn from them because that gives example of how to manage in a democratic way without using the traditional representative democracy, which is creating a lot of problems. Because the problem of the representative democracy that the selection of the best people, and the best people are the elite. It's good to have other way to act in democratic way, and we have a lot of things to learn, in my opinion, from the management of Wikipedia or the internet or this kind of things.
Hello, I'm Italian and I'm from Option A, and I wanted to ask you a more philosophical question, it's a related to the fact that nowadays we are living in a historical moment where basically we are what we have. We are what we have. Mm-hmm. And so just wanted to ask you in that time, how could we make actually people care of commons?
People?
Care of commons.
Oh, but I think we do. I don't think that we are in a reality when we are what we have. Look at your relationship with your friends here in the room.
I was. That's my feeling about how society is going nowadays, and it's also. For example, what was said by Bauman. Mm-hmm. I was thinking about this dream, like if we live in a world that is that much focused on things that really belongs to us and they define us as well. How could what's the reason why people should take care of something that, that is not owned, but it's common.
Now, what I wanted to say, of course, you are totally right. The system pushes us to consume. And
yeah, that's what I wanted to say.
And to exist through our private goods. I have a big car, I am a big man. This kind of caricature, for example. But honestly, I think that in particular among you, the young people, the youngest from related to me at least, there is a different feeling. Frankly, will you find a nice boyfriend or girlfriend or whatever only because he has a big car? Of course not. And I'm sure that in the room, no one will be impressed by the size of the car, whatever I say the car. It's an example of the goods owned by someone to find a partner in life. It's not your dream, I'm sure. And that shows that the society is reacting against that. That doesn't mean that what you said is wrong. It's true that the system pushes us to do that. But I am interested by the strength of the counter-reaction and the strength of the volunteer of people to do things by themselves. Look at the food consumption. The people want to have short circuit. They want to buy local things. They prefer the slow food than the bad junk food. And we have a huge movement like that. And I don't know the details of your opinion and your believing, but I'm sure that most of us were like that. And it's not, we are not a sort of isolated Iceland. You have the two movements at the same time in the society, a movement of consumption and, as you said, to be what you have, but you have a huge movement of people wanting to do different things.
Yeah, yeah. I feel like you're really positive about that. Because, sorry, but I would also to mention the example of Naples that also Ettore mentioned, because this summer I went to do a tour of the city, and I noticed that in some of the common areas, like squares, like archaeological park, people keep throwing what they have, like garbage. Mm-hmm. Yeah, and so it's like people have something in common which is so meaningful, but still they don't care. They just do not.
But you know that we have 40 million tourists every year in this city. 40 million. It's the most visited city in the world. And of course, that's created a little bit of garbage and shit everywhere. I agree with that. But not so much. Maybe it's my positive and optimist.
Okay. Yeah, probably it's me that have that attitude. But
hello. I'm Iltiana from Option A. And I come from Albania.
From Romania?
Albania.
Albania.
Albania, yeah. I wanted to focus a bit on the domain of knowledge commons. And I wanted to know your opinion about the governance of this kind of commons. How does that work? And particularly in the open access initiative, which was mentioned also in the presentation. For example, in other scientific journals, there are like specific, let's say, scientific staff or editors who take care about the gatekeeping process. And I was just curious about how does the gatekeeping process work in this specific initiative, and who assesses the quality of the papers that will be published, or who picks the ones?
Honestly, it's not my field of knowledge. I suppose what I heard about, but it's really, take what I said with prudence. Maybe I'm wrong. I think there is different kind of management. I think that there is some academic free online newspaper journal who accept everything. And they publish whatever you people want to put in. But most of them are more keeping the peer-to-peer review, which is the traditional system. Because one of the scandals, in my opinion, of the private journal, scientific journal, is that not only the academics who are writing papers are not paid, which is perfectly normal because they are paid by the university. They don't need to be paid by the journal. But even the peer-to-peer people are not paid neither. I suppose you were peer-to-peer review of academic paper. You are never paid. When I did it, I was never paid, and it's normal as well, huh, because I'm paid by my company or by the university. It's not a problem. But who are benefiting of that? The private company. And I know that some of the free access journals are also using the peer-to-peer, you know, all the system of the peer-to-peer review, you know how that works. I think so. But take what I said with prudence. Huh? For me, there is the two models, but maybe I'm wrong.
Hello, my name is Julian. I'm from option B. I'm from Argentina. So my question will be, so taking into account the experience that is now developing in Catalonia and Barcelona, I was going to ask you to expand a little bit more on that, but that ship has sailed. So how would you actually evaluate the success of this system based in commons in order to, because if you want to generalize something, you need to show positive results. What would be the criteria to actually judge if this system is working against the benchmark, usually the benchmark of efficiency and, let's say, equality? What would be this benchmark for to evaluate commons?
Mm-hmm. The difficulty is that there is so many different commons that it's difficult to have a unique benchmark system or evaluation system. Some of the commons are totally winning the war. Look at Wikipedia. There is no chance for Encyclopedia Universalis, which is the French one, or the Britannica in the Anglo-Saxon world, to win against. Forget it, it's done. In other sectors, you have good companies who are able to compete. The biggest success of a quite big company as a cooperative, it's Mondragon. You know probably them. It's a Basque country, but it's a worldwide cooperative. It's a Basque cooperative. It's from the Basque country. And they are able to have a relatively good social policy. It's not perfect, but relatively good, and to have a good economic efficiency.
Okay, so the criteria implicitly is if they can survive in the market against the private companies, then they should be there. We shouldn't push for something that is not, let's say, naturally winning the war, as you said, put it.
No, depend what you want to say. In the case of Wikipedia, it's not a competition in the market, because Wikipedia is free, and there is no market for that. But of course, Mondragon sells things. They are selling goods, in particular in the white industry, all the fridge and all those things. And of course, they are in a competitive market because we are in phases of globalization, and they have to sell in competition with other companies. I'm not telling that's good. I will prefer, but that's require a political change of the system at worldwide level. It's quite challenging for the long term. So we could imagine another system, but today they have to do that. But what's interesting in the comment that you have a lot of things who are not comparable. Look at all, for example, we have here in this country, but I'm sure that in a lot of your country you have that direct relationship now more and more between farmers and people. And of course, it's not a market, because when a group of habitants in the city of Paris pass an agreement with one or two or three farmers, there is a sort of monopoly de facto because the people passing an agreement. That shows that it's possible to have a lot of different level of commons, if you want, who are working well. This system in French, we name it the AMAP. I don't know how to tell it in English. Is this kind of direct link between farmers, and I'm sure you have it in Argentina, in several places, I don't know, in the US you have a lot of them, and that changed really the relationship between people, and it worked well. Thank you.